I hate the feeling of being trapped in a paradox. For instance, the more you tell yourself to fall asleep, the harder it gets. The more you tell someone who's agitated to calm down, the more agitated they get. The more I tell you to not think of a blue dog, the more you think of a blue dog. These paradoxes can become traps when you don't know how to get out of them. It can feel extremely uncomfortable when you're stuck in one of them. It can be terrible to not be able to sleep at night, but what if one of these paradoxes prevent you from being who you are? What if they prevent you from being the artist you want to be? Kurt Cobain was a prominent victim of this paradox, and this trap has claimed yet another victim, Banksy. I'm going to read you a lengthy quote from Mark Fisher's Capitalist Realism on Kurt Cobain.
Well, just right here, I just looked up the definition of paradox. None of those three things he mentioned are paradoxes.
Yeah.
I mean, a paradox, and this is from online, Merriam-Webster. A seemingly absurd or self-contradictory statement or proposition that when investigated or explained may prove to be well-founded or true. So I tell you, don't think of a cow, and you think of a cow.
There's really no investigation there that you need to do. Yeah. I mean, we understand why. Like, you literally said the word cow, so, and it's going to be in your brain. You know,
his premise of why to get into it is totally false. Not that it has any real bearing on what comes afterward, but just listening to him, I thought to myself, let me look up, maybe it's like definition numbers 17A, but no.
But it's another one of those things where it's like, where with YouTube, you have to, you know, keep it snappy, keep it moving. You know, we're 52 seconds in. He has like a series of paradoxes that he presented, well, according to him, right? Then he connects it to the arts more broadly. Then he starts getting to Kurt Cobain. And then before we even hit the 1 minute mark, he's pulling out a book called Capitalist Realism. You know,
he's trying to show, see, I'm smart. I've talked often about negative capability, the John Keats idea of bringing disparate things together, that once you bring them together, they don't seem so disparate. He's trying to do that. But immediately what he's set up is false. So he starts with a false premise. And so his attempt to try to sound wise or whatnot falls flat on its face.
And another thing, it's like when you're pulling out books, it's like when I watch videos, like I want to know what you think, right? I don't care about some random book. I don't care about somebody.
Authority.
Yeah, exactly. Or do you have anything interesting to say, right? Because that's another thing. Like even if it's an appeal to an authority where the authority is actually saying something that's sensible, for the most part, right, I'm looking for people that maybe have like novel insights themselves. So
I promise. Capitalism seamlessly occupies the horizons of the thinkable. Frederick Jameson used to report in horror about the ways that capitalism has seeped into the very unconscious. Now the fact that capitalism has colonized the dreaming life of the population is so taken for granted that it is no longer worthy of comment. Witness, for instance, the establishment of settled alternative or independent cultural zones, which endlessly repeat older gestures of rebellion and contestation as if for the first time. Alternative and independent don't designate something outside the mainstream culture, rather, they are styles, in fact, the dominant styles within the mainstream. No one embodied and struggled with this deadlock more than Kurt Cobain and Nirvana.
The way that he describes kind of like how, you know, resistance to a culture looks like, that's literally how it always is. I mean, that's just kind of like the process of change and synthesis. And like even like the ironic thing here is just how this quote is supposed to be talking about, you know, this phenomenon of like everything being essentially kind of like, I guess, subsumed under, you know, I guess the rubric of capitalism and perhaps some other things. And yet, you know, he's kind of like describing something that's even like pre-capitalism, right? We're talking about a kind of like long term of how human beings tend to behave. And it's being it itself is being passed off as an insight, as something new, as if for the first time. Right. And he's not, you know, he's not able to comment on that.
And this deadlock more than, I mean, the language he's using. Yes. Kurt Cobain was a modern day Atlas.
In his dreadful lassitude and objectless rage, Cobain seemed to give wearied voice to the despondency of the generation that had come after history, whose every move was anticipated, tracked, bought, and sold before it had even happened. Cobain knew that he was just another piece of spectacle, that nothing runs better on MTV than a protest against MTV, knew that his every move was a cliché scripted in advance, knew that even realizing it is a cliché. Here, even success meant failure, since to succeed would only mean that you were the new meat on which the system could feed.
And I don't know to what extent it's just kind of like his own words or how much of this is just like continuation of the quotations. But I mean, there's nothing obviously that prevented Kurt Cobain from doing something different if he had so desired, right? It's true that you are taken by things like MTV. At the same time, like one thing that gets me about so many people is like, especially when people have like a pretty big audience, wouldn't you want to like start doing your own thing and sort of like lead these people wherever you want to lead them, irrespective of like anything that, you know, someone else might think? Because like, it's one thing if you have to like build up an audience, but once it's already there, you could literally do whatever you want. They're going to follow you. So
Cobain's angst was commodified. It became a product. So the more he expressed his angst, even if it was targeted at his own commodification, the more value he gave to that commodity. If he was pissed at MTV, that anger was going to be milked by MTV itself. There's no way he could escape it. Even Cobain's very suicide added value to his commodification. Now, let's talk about Banksy. His rage, or at least his indignation, is not objectless like Cobain's. Banksy has targeted war, authoritarianism, capitalism, the bourgeoisie, greed, and, more apropos for this video, the art market. This last sentiment is best expressed in a quote by art critic Robert Hughes, shared by Banksy. But the price of a work of art is now part of its function. Its new job is to sit on the wall and get more expensive. Instead of being the common property of humankind the way a book is, art becomes the particular property of somebody who can afford it.
Do you guys want to talk about that?
Well, I was just looking at my original comment underneath and arguing with someone. If I can, let me just read my first comment. I won't read anything else yet, but it's like yours here. Because I wrote, and this was back 8 months ago, I'm not a fan of capitalism, but this is a very bad taste. One, neither Cobain nor Banksy were great artists. It's interesting that not a single qualitative comment, much less judgment, was uttered in this video. You spoke about the art as commodity and art without once speaking of the thing that is the coin of exchange in art over the eons, quality. Two, hence you, meaning Bandana Boy, hence you are a commoditizer. Three, you fail to acknowledge that both of them chose to be commodities. It was not thrust on them. They were not trapped. They leapt inside the game to play it. Cobain's mental ills and addictions proved it was a bad mood for him, but he chose to be a rock star. He chose to marry a rock star. He chose to throw his angst and domestic abuse out into the world to commoditize it. And no one in the art world takes Banksy seriously as an artist. He is the embodiment of Warhol 2.0. He chooses to play his outrage, even though he is immensely benefited by it, with little artistic quality given back to society. Even more than Cobain, he is part of the problem, a sellout who pretends he's not a sellout. He's like David Foster Wallace was to the MFA writing mafia. And now, and look how you present this take, and with all the other ones, you use a wholly generic YouTube perfected vocal style. And I go on about that, but this was one of the obviously bad takes. Here, and there's many on his channel, but this was one of the worst.
Wait, so you think that Banksy is not taken seriously by the art world? Because I mean, to me, saying Andy Warhol 2.0, I feel like generically, if you just ask people now what they think about Andy Warhol, they're like, oh yeah, that was a great important artist.
No one in the art world who knows anything takes him seriously.
Oh, yeah.
They take him seriously in terms of capital, but you know, he's not, who's the guy from New York who is the well-known graffiti artist, the black fellow who died in the 80s.
You know, if we are talking about like, you know, they're taken seriously specifically because of, you know, the kind of like monetary value that they produce, like on the wall, he's critiquing this, but he's not actually offering an alternative. Yeah. He's not actually like discussing Banksy. He's not actually discussing Andy Warhol. He's not actually discussing the work of Kurt Cobain. And this, to me, it's like, it's one of these things where they try to, be respectful, like in these kinds of, I guess, like, you know, by organizing their thoughts about the artist in such a way. And yet, to me, it's like total disrespect that the work itself is just never actually analyzed. I mean, if you are an artist, like, that's the number one thing that you want people to do, right? Much more than, you know, getting money, much more than anything, right? You want a society to somehow be affected by what you're doing, right? You want to have a positive effect. And if there aren't people to discuss the work itself, I mean,
The art market turns a work of art into a commodity, a rare commodity, which can make it a very good investment in the right circumstances. To some, that's a good thing. To others, it's a tragedy. Art, in many ways, is now appreciated not for its power, its beauty, or its challenging nature, but for its value and for its ability to generate more wealth for its owner. Think of Banksy's Central Park kiosk, where he hired a man to present spray art priced at $60. The artworks didn't get much attention. People weren't drawn to them, at least not enough to purchase them. However, had anybody known these were Banksy works, the kiosk would have been empty in a matter of seconds. However, this old man sold Banksy's artworks to people who liked them, either for themselves or to offer as gifts. If Banksy had sold them, he wouldn't have sold artworks, but investments, high-value commodities. Again, to some people, that's great. An artwork can be both great as an artwork and as an investment. But to other people, Banksy included, this can hinder our ability to appreciate art. I would argue that because we are brought up in a commodified world, we cannot dissociate the value of a work of art and its price tag. So when the bourgeoisie estimates the price of a work at $2 million.
And when he says that's nothing, like words like we, what exactly is he referring to? Like he himself can't do it. Is he talking about like a social tendency? And when he says cannot, like, is that like definitively cannot, or are we just talking about a tendency in society, you know? It's just like a lot of like sloppy language. I guess, I mean, I could keep going on and on about the language, but there is a ton of sloppy language in a lot of these, you know, art first channels. And I mean, it's not actually too different from many other things. Like if you look at how like science people, how they communicate, that tends to be a problem. Like very recently, there was this row between Robert Kennedy Jr. and some, you know, like doctor, like a, you know, who's like talking about vaccination publicly, who refuses to debate. And it's like, why? You know, like, is it really because you know, like verbally, you know, like a scientist and even artists or even like writers themselves, very often when it comes to actual discussion, they don't really cultivate that ability.
It's hard to not have that impair our judgment. However, that $2 million price tag is not about the work of art in itself. It's about how much this work can be worth in the future and how much you as a buyer can gain from it. And this is extremely harmful for artists, either the ones who are beginning or the ones who don't plan on having an international career. The art market promotes the idea of investing in art, of spending with the idea of reselling for a higher price. If you buy a painting from a local artist solely because you really like it, you might not be able to resell it for its original value. Honestly, you might not be able to resell it at all, and to the art market, that's a bad investment. It comes to no surprise that the art market has little to nothing to do with art, and more with wealth, speculation, and investment. I think a true collector, someone who genuinely appreciates art, can buy an artwork from someone who's completely unknown, and it wouldn't matter to them because they bought the art not for the name, not for the return on investment, but for the work in itself. If you buy a work of art to later profit from it, no matter what they tell you, you're not buying a work of art. You're placing money on a nice looking investment. So I started this video by talking about how both Cobain and Banksy were stuck in the same trap. But what is this trap exactly? Banksy's greatest anti-art market stunt was, without a doubt, his shredding of the girl with balloon. In a nutshell, if you haven't heard about it, this work of art destroyed itself after being sold at auction. Banksy protested against the art market by destroying his work of art after it was sold. If you ask me, it's an incredible idea, but just like with Kurt Cobain, it would just add value to the commodity. When Cobain protested against MTV, he empowered MTV. When Banksy protests against the art market, he empowers the art market. This is the trap. No matter how much you protest the thing you hate, your protest won't only be unsuccessful, but detrimental to your goal. As Fisher wrote, here even success meant failure, since to succeed would only mean that you were the new meat on which the system could feed. Banksy is immensely successful, and if Banksy is the new meat on which the system can feed, Banksy is a feast. And
I mean, like, talking about all this, like, it makes me wonder, is the implication that non-commodified art is going to be necessarily better? Because, you know, it perhaps is going to be more diverse, right? More places for art to come from, but it being, you know, better or worse is not necessarily, you know, very clear to me, right? It's just going to be different. And, you know, stuff like, you know, Banksy shredding the artwork as a protest. The issue is that, you know, it's no longer there, right? Like it's like people should be much more concerned about actually producing, right? Getting stuff out there, getting their poems written, getting their books written, getting their paintings done. You know, all this other stuff is just like a total sideshow, right? Nobody here is like really talking about, you know, the actual work ethic. People are getting like so caught up on all these like outside issues. Like, is this a spectacle? Is it not a spectacle? And it's like, why don't you just actually do the thing and make it worthwhile? Like, if it's additive, if this is all additive in some way, why would it matter, right? What other kind of like categories that you could attach it to, right? The bottom line is, you know, if an artwork is additive, the only way that it could be additive is that there's something worthwhile within it, right? So if Banksy had a worthwhile painting in that balloon girl or whatever, by virtue of it being destroyed, that is, you know, like forget about like it being like a trolling of art buyers. Like if you really created a great work of art and you stand on it as being a great work of art, destroying it is a negative quality, obviously.
This is not only true for art. Social movements and even anti-capitalist ideas can be incorporated by capitalism and resold to us. The art market knows that Banksy is going to criticize it. The billionaires buying Banksy art know that Banksy will criticize them, and they love it. The art market and billionaires don't see these attacks as dangerous. Why not? Banksy's stunt was one of the largest stunts in art history. We have one of the most successful artists in the world completely and publicly rejecting the main institution of the art world, the art market. It's a huge deal, with little to no impact. The reason why Banksy's criticism is not only ineffective but beneficial to the art market is because it's all a spectacle. Events, experiences, and art are commodified and sold to us. They become a spectacle, a show comparable to a Netflix movie. Our relation to these events can often feel detached, mostly because they are sold to us almost as fiction. The mediation between us and the world through images creates this alienating disconnection. Kurt Cobain killed himself. This, relayed through mass media, is sold to us. It's used to grab our attention. It becomes a spectacle. This degradation of the real in favor of the spectacle is what makes everything feel like a show, like it's all fake. When seeing Banksy's girl with balloon being shredded as it's being bought for several hundreds of thousands of dollars, we see it like we would see a harmless performance in a circus. It's being sold to us as such. The critique becomes a spectacle, and the spectacle, not the critique, becomes the content. No matter what Banksy does, it will be commodified. Banksy has become a spectacle, the same way Cobain did. No matter what they do, whatever they say, that will contribute to their value as commodities. Cobain knew that he was just another piece of spectacle, that nothing runs better on MTV than a protest against MTV. Banksy is just another piece of spectacle. Nothing runs better in the art world than a protest against the art world. Everything Banksy does will become an element of the spectacle and, therefore, a commodity to be advertised and sold. The painting being shredded is part of the spectacle. Banksy's anonymous identity is part of the spectacle. Graffiti is part of the spectacle. When Banksy and only Banksy does illegal graffiti, it's acceptable, it's funny, it's part of the show. Cobain and Banksy were turned into spectacles to a point where their protests or their rage became meaningless. Their acts were just spectacles, entertainment bits that are packaged and sold to us just like any other commodity is. This commodification of these performances, these experiences, and these artists make me worry. Kurt Cobain was so well integrated to MTV culture that even when he criticized MTV, he participated in that culture. Banksy is so well integrated in the art world that even when they criticize the art world, they participate in its culture. How can an artist possibly criticize any institution which they have been so well integrated with? Doesn't that rob the artist from their power? What would Banksy have to do to really harm the art world and its market? Well, they couldn't make any artwork because that would contribute to the art world culture of criticizing the art world. What if they stopped making art? Well, that could also contribute to the mystery and myth of Banksy, the spectacle. Banksy is trapped. As long as they're an artist in the public eye, they'll participate, contribute, and empower the very thing they hate without any chance of meaningfully criticizing.
Here's where he goes wrong. It's assuming that Banksy doesn't know this. And for, number one, Banksy is not likely one person. I've read many things where Banksy is probably a group of two or three artists that use the moniker Banksy. So it's not a single individual, but he makes it as if this concern, supposed concern that he has, is something that motivated Cobain and Banksy, and there's no evidence of that. It's all for the shock value and whatnot. And that's from the very first time, 25, 30 years ago, when Banksy first became known, and Cobain a little bit before that. So this whole assumption that he had that's behind this video is, again, a false one.
Yeah. And again, like, I just keep asking myself, like, who cares? Like, you know, to the extent that, oh, you know, this is it all becomes meaningless. Like, the only reason why Banksy or Kurt Cobain would be meaningless is if their music, right, or their artwork is just not sufficient, right? Or if there's, like, not enough people that are able to, like, articulate why it works. Apparently, you know, he can't even do that, right? I mean, he himself said that I'm more interested in the cognition aspect of all this, which is why it's all context driven. Like, and a lot of this, honestly, like, it just strikes me as, especially these final comments of his, they strike me as somebody is almost like justifying to himself why he would not go become an artist, right? Because, like, first of all, if you want to be a great artist, it's very difficult and there's not much compensation there, right? It's not like having a YouTube channel. He's kind of like trying to justify almost to himself, like, look how trapped they are, and they are supposed to be at the top of their game.
And the thing is, my comment that I read earlier, I ended it by saying this to him. And as I type, you have almost 30,000 views in a day, mimicking other YouTube narrators and complaining about a problem that, at least for your two victims, is not really a problem. And how much will you get from YouTube for this shallow and disingenuous take? Are you trapped, or is it you that has YouTube in a snare? There's nothing here that he's saying that is in any way any kind of an issue, except as a faux issue presented to again get him clickbait.
Yeah, using words like trap, like, it just makes me think, like, trapped according to who, you know,
right?
Who's trapped and why, right? And, like, it sort of works at the beginning if he's talking about Kurt Cobain, because at least there's, like, the specter of the suicide or whatever. But for Banksy, you think Banksy's trapped, right? He's like, you know, whoever he or they are, you know, multimillionaires, get tons of, like, you know, has, like, a reputation, right? Nobody's trapped, right? It's just like a word. It's like a total made up word that somebody is, like, using now to get at everything other than the thing itself, which is the production of work over and over and over again. You know, I like how he, like, presents, like even if you do believe that you're in some way, like, trapped by capitalism, he presents this idea of a great artist just, like, suddenly stopping work as a solution to something. Like, solution to what? Like, what would that be a solution to? Some made up problem in his own head, you know? I'm not sure if Zeke,
I'll confess, this is the first time I've seen this video all the way through, but I mean, I think you're all right. I'm just not sure what this video adds or what it's supposed to do. Like, it seems to, like, lionize the idea of being self-aware about your inability to do anything in the art world and its commodification. And all you can do is just sort of make these sort of ineffectual, gimmicky spectacles. But wouldn't the real sort of rebellion would be to focus on producing great art?
Yeah, exactly. Nobody's doing that.
That would be the actual sort of countercultural idea. But again, this guy, he doesn't go into what constitutes quality art and what the art of Cobain was or what the art of Banksy is, and maybe how, in fact, the art may have contributed to sort of this endless cycle of spectacle and commercialization. So, yeah, I mean, like you said, I think Dan's original comment was, like, you don't go into the art of Nirvana or how it's successful. And I think that's probably the most important part of it, because that's what they did for a living. And this sort of discussion just oversteps that completely, to talk about capitalism in this way that I think most educated people in the world can understand. And this whole thing is monetized. So, like, what is he doing? Is he just sort of, is he not contributing to the to the same commercialization and ineffectual conversation about art and all that. But yeah, I mean,
yeah, and he would say, "I'm trapped too." You know,
I'm trapped. Like, yeah, we're all trapped.
And that would be a humble brag, right? I'm trapped. Right. I'm trapped with over 1 million subscribers, right? And you know, we said about the ultimate act of rebellion, the arts. Yeah, I mean, that is true. Like, think about how, you know, so many like young kids would be looking for, you know, what would be countercultural, and hard work is not considered very sexy. You know, it's considered a very boring response to that question. And yet it is in fact the ultimate response, isn't it? Right. The production of hard, of good quality work, no matter the genre, no matter the aesthetic preoccupations, just the continued, I mean, like even like my channel name, Automachination, part of that, at least part of that idea, right? This kind of process of, you know, just keep going, keep doing. And eventually, you know, things take up a life of their own.